Yeah.
Hello, and welcome to Foot the Bill, where we audit your favorite media. My name is Trey, and today we want to talk to you,
Mark Hoffman, detective. Once and future Jigsaw apprentice, now with both hands on the wheel. This blue-toned Snow White has been given a free pass by his deceased boss to get out of this mess of a plotline. But can he truly escape the chains that bind? Is Hoffman a murderer capable of becoming the next Jigsaw, thrusting his victims into traps that resemble the justice of a James Bond villain? Or is Hoffman actually a victim in all of this, trapped in a cycle of violence perpetuated by the Machiavellian ghost of one John the Jigsaw Kramer? Frankly, the only chains I care about are the chains of capitalism, dollars, and cents. Your innocence is not on the chopping block today, Hoffman, only your bank account. But first, the rules.
Those are the rules, Harold. I'm sorry.
No utilities get charged. Purchases are calculated in the year depicted in the media we're analyzing. Saw 6 is still in the same time frame as Saws 3 through 5, so we're still futzing about in what I estimate to be between 2006 and 2007. Location-based scavenging is permitted, as well as anything that could be fleeced from a junkyard. This game takes place after the meatpacking plant, but a lot of the traps here were likely constructed concurrently with those traps. We'll be continuing to add expenses to the data we've generated across the five films of the franchise so far, breaking down Hoffman's expenses versus John's, as well as totaling the costs for each film. If you need to catch up on where we've been so far, I'll link the playlist in the corner. I'll wait for you to check that out. Yeah, you. And that includes you, my dedicated FBI agent. I know you haven't subscribed yet. We're really close to 20,000, so go ahead and pass a clipboard around the office. Subs means NordVPN sponsorships, which means we can shake our FBI tail. Don't tell him, though. So, Hoffman the Great has ascended the throne, but do his coffers overflow with the funding necessary to overhaul a zoo? Let's find out. The movie opens to Shakespeare. It's The Merchant of Venice, with Billy as Shylock. Only this time around, he's getting his pound of flesh. The two victims are Simone and Eddie, and apparently they're loan sharks. Billy informs them that they have 60 seconds to tip the scale in their favor, or they're screwed, via the temples, by a very gnarly, old-school-looking trap. The trap works like this. The room is bisected by a scale, with two tubes leading down to its plates. In each of their cells are a table with a cleaver and another scream knife like we saw in Saw 2. The victims are encouraged to cut, cleave, and dismember themselves to achieve freedom. Two pin power inhibitors on both victims activate the lights and television, run the tape, and then activate the timer on the wall. Whoever tips their scales is freed, while the other's helmet activates a kill state via a wireless signal. The helmets themselves, therefore, have a number of servos, micro switches, timers, as well as battery power units, wireless receivers, and corresponding wireless broadcasters. That's a decent amount of tech for an otherwise old-school gears and screws build. Alright, now that we know the rules, let's see how this plays out. Oh god, I can't show any of this. Oh, this is way too much. Oh god. Simone wins, hot damn. To the victor goes the crown, or I guess the lack thereof would probably be better. Future footage of the crime scene reveals a corkboard with surveillance of Simone and Eddie, and the obligatory sedatives necessary to kidnap and drag them here. So we're off to a good start! Snow White is getting dropped off post-trash compactor, where it's revealed the switch for opening the room was in the hallway. Strom's a little worse for wear. Gross. We're zipped away to a very busy office that reeks of bullshit. This is William Easton on the phone with his babe.
Hey, babe. Good. Listen, I am so, so sorry, but I can't make dinner.
And you can tell this guy likes to play games with people's lives. Dice on the desk, chess in the back. But we're not here to charge him for decor. Easton explains that he's built an algorithm that determines whether or not a patient deserves healthcare coverage. That algorithm looks a lot like six people using Google, but what the fuck do I know? Hey, wait, is this health insurance company called Umbrella? Like that Umbrella? A ball rolls out of Easton's head, and we're taken to Hoffman, who is hanging out in a new secret evil lair. He's reviewing a recording of the opening trailer Trap on a Nagra 4S. These are the cream of the crop when it comes to portable audio review and manipulation. They were designed originally for the alphabet soup, that is, the US federal agencies. CIA, NSA, FBI. Looking at you, FBI agent, did you subscribe? Resale value of these machines floats around $3,000, plus or minus a few grand, but that's a fair estimate for 2006. Hoffman gets called over to the Trap from the beginning of the film. The FBI is involved, Strom's prints have been found on the crime scene, and someone is taking issue with that. His former partner returned from the dead, Agent Perez. Also, peek over her shoulder to see the surveillance corkboard for our two victims. See? At the hospital, that reporter who's been lurking around the last couple of movies is hounding Hoffman for deets. You're not getting deets! Stop asking for deets! No one says deets! Hoffman interviews the surviving victim, I guess to get a feel for how well she'd be as an apprentice. It doesn't go well.
What? What am I supposed to learn from this?
Just breathe.
Look at me!
We catch up with Jill, tripping through time like she's got a secret ocarina. She reveals some details about the box. Some mysterious mechanism, 6 envelopes, and a lot of wine. Oof. Envelope 2 reveals the reporter, and we're back in Hoffman's world, catching up with some actual police work. Turns out, forensics exists and blows open Hoffman's MO, a serrated scalpel. You just ended up on a list, Mr. Coroner. Hoffman teleports to Jill's clinic, where he's ready to pick up his next assignment. Only this time, he's decided he's the instructor.
All you need to know is that from now on, I control all aspects of the game.
Jill hands over the envelopes, Hoffman announces his solo career, and the final game is on. Back in Easton's office, the news is lying through their teeth about the weather when the power goes out. His security guard is trying to save him as quietly as possible, but Easton shoots him instead and gets kidnapped by a pig. Good job, everyone. Easton comes to getting the Saul Guerrera treatment. He's greeted by Jigsaw.
Hello, William.
Oh, jeez.
Who explains to Easton in a very personal tape that the privatized healthcare system is a fucking nightmare and deserves to be torn down brick by brick. Today, those bricks are Easton and everything he cares about. He has 4 tasks ahead of him, with 4 bombs on each of his limbs. Fail the task, lose the limb. Succeed and progress. Easton has 60 minutes to complete his game. The machine encompassing him and his employee is the actuated stress-timed humane masochistic apparatus, or ASTHMA for short, and it works like this. Easton and Hank, that's Hank by the way, are both chained hand and foot upright into a contraption. On their faces are non-invasive breathing apparatuses connected to a medical bellows that measures their breathing. A small motor moves a sensor into place, lit by some cold cathode tubes. When they breathe in deep, that sensor triggers a larger motor that drives a cog that slides rails with teeth that move clamps inwards towards their rib cages. You can think of it like an oversized monkey wrench or a spanner, with your torso acting like the pipe. Once a kill state is achieved, the clamps reverse direction. To the victor go the spoils as the wrist and leg chains disengage. The winner of the game is whoever holds their breath, indefinitely. So, let's see, a well-paid corporate stooge or a chain-smoking janitor? Well, let's see who, Well, that checks out. Yeah, I guess we do need more movie. Easton's explosive wrist and ankle guards are an ongoing problem for him, but success here means that he's freed one such shackle. A light activates across the room, indicating where to go next. Oh, and I guess because he was stalked prior to this trap, we can account for some surveillance as well. Adam's being kept very busy for this film. A security camera has been watching Easton's asthma attack from the safety of what I like to call the acid lounge. A really nice TV shows off the view of Easton's adventures through the murder zoo, and actually, we need to talk about that TV. So, canonically, this film takes place the same year that Hoffman walked out of that meatpacking plant, 2006. Now, television technology was changing rapidly at this time. CRTs, LCDs, and plasma TVs were competing for the world's living rooms. And with competition, prices go down. But with emerging technology, other prices go up. And more importantly, this TV is wide. It's also on a stand and has very little, if any, curve to the screen. I think CRT can safely be ruled out. But that means we're looking at an LCD or plasma TV canonically in 2006. Even used, these were not cheap. It'd be like shopping for a used OLED TV today. You're still paying a lot of money. Look, I'll give Jigsaw's wallet the benefit of the doubt and charge for LCD prices here because you do not want to be buying a plasma TV in 2006. Thankfully, this issue never comes up again in the franchise. There's a camera in the lounge watching Tara and Brent, that's Tara and that's Brent, as well as a timer that they can see. In the corner is a big honking jug of what might be hydrofluoric acid, but hey, maybe it's a red herring and it's actually just oxygen. I'll save calculating this corner piece for later though, but we can include surveillance and sedatives for both of these two knuckleheads. A creepy Hoffman tells us about as much as he watches from the one-way mirror. He also confirms that the next kidnapping victim is investigative journalist Pamela Jenkins. We see Pamela currently lurking outside Jill's apartment when she's pignapped by Hoffman. She's now passed out in the adjoining cage. We also get a good look at Hoffman's little security setup and his growing corkboard of subjects. Keeping Adam busy. Back in the halls, Easton remarks upon his wild youth spent partying with none other than John Kramer. Bro, I bet that shit was lit. All kinds of crazy ass shenanigans. Easton decides to tour the reptile room when he's introduced to a Stretch Armstrong test machine, challenging him personally. Easton, the weakling, decides not to entertain the contest. However, the bomb on his wrist checks his decision, and he begrudgingly returns to the carnival challenge. What we call the human auto neck gallows of unfortunate timing, or hangout. The ringmaster for the night is Billy! Ha-ha! Here to adorably explain the rules.
Only one can exit this room, and the choice of whom falls upon you. You must let go of one to save the life of the other.
It's time once again for Easton's policy to be put into action. His secretary Addie has a big family, but with a history of diabetes, while his file clerk Alan is basically the forever alone meme. Rough stuff, man. Billy zips into the ceiling. And the game begins in earnest. So let's break all this down. Those monitors are being repurposed. There's a good chance there's a computer under there feeding the images into the room. The double winch system up at the ceiling could very well have been part of the zoo exhibit. I'm not sure what this room was entirely, but I can't say it wasn't already a room with a winch. That said, we do have three motors at play tugging on both of Easton's chains and hoisting Billy up and out of sight. Jesus Christ, that's hilarious. There's also Billy himself looking dapper as ever, and the internal timers and mechanisms to sync up his speech to the recording. I'm charging extra for this because when he's in a videotape and talking, I can't say for sure that's not just someone with a hand inside him. But here, hanging out, no hands. There's an internal timer to link up to the end of the recording with hoisting Billy, as well as timers on the chains to tug at different intervals. Speaking of timed intervals, Easton decides that diabetes is cooler than solitude and chooses Addie to live. Some electromagnets, I guess, disconnect Alan's shackles? And a motor pulls the steel cable and pulley out from under his platform. Alan can't scream through that silk gag, but he can bleed. And bleed he does! Another motor pulls his body up. Why? And Easton is free to proceed to the next room, a timer showing him the way out. Another key unlocks another shackle, and another camera follows his journey through the healthcare system. In the adjoining cage, April O'Neil is banging on the walls before locating her microcassette player and tape.
Hello, Pamela. You've sensationalized my life, twisting the truth and exploiting my message for your own benefit.
As Pamela gets acquainted with the voices in her cage, Hoffman pins up the next victim, Easton's lawyer, Debbie. But first, he gets a call from Sony Ericsson that there's been a break in the case. A flashback to the rack gets in the way when we're treated to some hostility between Amanda and Hoffman. No one talks about the tension between these two enough. I hope that we get some of that later on in the franchise. I mean, she's dead, so we won't. Anyway. John decides that the unconscious man about to have his head twisted off is still a person.
As a human being. Do you like how brutality feels, Mark?
And we're back in the zoo with Easton, where things are getting steamy. Yet another flashback takes us to the moment Easton denied John his experimental treatment in Mexico, which, in hindsight, is probably the most responsible thing Easton ever did in this franchise. Like, can you imagine the phone call between Easton and Cecilia? Hilarious. Anyway, Easton threatens to drop John from his healthcare altogether, and John decides to act really entitled about it. But eventually, John suggests that they go get sushi and stay friends. What are we having, John?
piranha.
That's not sushi, John. Get out of my office. Back at Elm Street, Easton is given a tape to explain his third challenge. STEAM, or stop turning every trap into an acronym, maze. This one is pretty simple. It's a STEAM maze, and it's Easton's job to guide Debbie to the end. If he can't do it in time, her cyber necktie will activate and spear her head, lobotomizing her to death. Debbie is currently gagged and shackled to the wall, but once that tape stops, the shackles are released and the rat race is on. A big timer reminds Easton that there's only half an hour left in the movie, and he gets to work guiding Debbie along. It's pretty slow going, as Easton insists on standing directly in front of every steam release pipe he encounters. Jesus. Debbie eventually double dare 2000s her way to the end, where she's met with the key to her freedom, Easton's liver. X-rays. Anyway, desperate for his liver, she attacks with what is totally a surgical grade saw, but Easton gets the drop on her. As her timer runs low, let's take a moment to describe the machinery on her person. This device operates similarly to the compression system that shot those tiny spears into the divorce trap. On her back is a compressed air pump, a microcontroller, and several tubes affixed to a leather harness secured to her body. Upon that little timer on her waist hitting zero, a pneumatic lever angles the projectile towards Debbie, and another system pipes air into that tube, which launches the spear into her head. Which is exactly what happens. Bye, Debbie. There she goes. Easton is awarded another key, waves to the camera, and moves on. That little grimace reveals that Pamela also has a personal TV with which to watch the events of the evening, and that she's one of the channels as well. Back at the FBI, evidence suggests that Strom has been moonlighting as an ice cream man, as Freon has been found present in his fingerprints. Neat, not so neat, is that the agents are pretty sure Seth Baxter's tape was not recorded by John, and they're in the process of unscrambling it now. Hoffman joins in the ride over to the revelation, kitchen timers be damned. That roast can wait. Jill forgot she had another envelope to give Hoffman and packs a lunch to go. It's probably wine. While Easton arrives at an early screening of Spiral, he opens the doors and the lights turn on to reveal a magnificently, hugely nauseating game of Buckshot Roulette. I'm not gonna acronym that. It turns out Easton's algorithm really is just 6 underpaid staff members. Jigsaw demands downsizing, so at least 4 of his staff have to die.
2 can live, 4 will die. Your decisions symbolized by the blood on your hands.
Here's how the room works. 6 staff members have been surveilled and kidnapped, and are now shackled to a carousel. A switch tied to the door Easton opened turned on the lights in the room, as well as the 6 spinning emergency lights. An old TV clicks on with Billy explaining the rules of the game. The shotgun will go off 6 times. Easton can insert his hand into that little box when the light turns on, and it'll raise the shotgun up towards the ceiling. But he can only do it twice. Save 2 lives, 4 people die. And the carousel spins the whole time, so boom. Buckshot Roulette. Breaking this down, we've got the shotgun itself as the primary thing to avoid in this trap. Good luck with that. There's an actuator that cocks the shotgun, some C-clamps affixed to that. The shooting mechanism involves a motor turning a bicycle pedal chain system, which is actually kind of cute. You know, I wonder how many bikes we could build with jigsaw traps? Anyway, another motor lifts the shotgun into the air. It looks like there's a car battery present to power everything, or at least prevent power from being disrupted. That's smart. There's also the motor driving the carousel, and not visible are the sensors and a computer linking the carousel to the gun. You see, the carousel never stops on the same target twice, and the selection of targets on the carousel can be seen in this pattern, with 1 representing Aaron and 6 being Josh. On Easton's side of things, there's a cage with some machinery inside of it, as well as a red light bulb on top. The machine inside is actually an old cast iron punch, typically used for rivets or punching holes in leather or other soft metals. These aren't particularly expensive, and it's not unreasonable that John would have had one in one of his workshops prior. Now, normally these machines are manually driven, but this one is motorized, with its activation keyed to the 2 switches. So a motor drives the punch, and a light on top of the box lights up to indicate that the shotgun is about to engage shooty time. Fun fact, when slowing this down, we can see that the way Easton's fingers are splayed out, the punch lines up in such a way as to minimize the damage to his hand. You know, that's very conscientious of Jigsaw. Let's see how it plays out. Easton seems like he actually tries to save Aaron, but just can't figure out how buttons work. After a bit of trauma spray, he manages to save Emily, but opts to pass on Gina, pregnant or not. After letting his star employee Dave also take one for the team, it's down to Shelby and Josh. Josh gives an outstanding ovation as to why he should live, and no dice. Josh does seem pleased at having had the opportunity to participate in a jigsaw game, though.
Look at me! When you're killing me, you look at me!
And thus, the algorithm is sufficiently broken. Single-payer healthcare for all! No?
Damn it!
Find another Easton. We're getting there one way or another. A timer at the back of the room reminds Easton he's on the clock, and a key releases another bomb accessory. Back at the FBI lab, Hoffman is introduced to the crack team working overtime to uncover his role as a Jigsaw copycat, apprentice, and heir apparent. Awkward. Also cool that there's two of the racks we saw in Saw 2. Goes to show the kind of tech that John used and the kind of tech the FBI uses to suss him out. Which makes sense too, because they would have had access to that lab. Ah, neat. Speaking of sussing, it sounds like the FBI are breathing down the neck of Hoffman. They've determined that Strom's fingerprints had to have been placed post-mortem. With the pressure mounting, Hoffman returns to his signature move, cheap office coffee. Cup in hand, he finds the courage to own up to his own mistakes. He was framed by John, blackmailed into service. He never meant to be dragged so deep. Just as his voice is resolved into the room,
right now you're there feeling it is. Helpless. Right now, you're feeling helpless.
Hoffman loosens Erickson's tie and offers some coffee to Perez. Seeing that Sachi might be thirsty after her big breakthrough, he takes her over to the coffee machine. Perez gives her a couple of shots, and Hoffman thanks her by, let's face it, shanking her into the wall. Hoffman, pleased with his work, needs to finish things up here before heading back to his game. Popping over to the trunk of his car, it's revealed that Hoffman took the Strom hand!
Shall I show you to your room?
Oh, that's heavy.
Woo! That's heavy!
I better use my strong hand.
Hoffman's been dragging the only remaining piece of Strom around the entire film, touching on everything in sight, now including the FBI office. He douses the place in gasoline, gives an extra portion to Erickson, looks thirsty, and torches the place. No charge for the coffee. This hot cup is on us. Jill arrives at the zoo with what I assume is 6 bottles of wine, with Hoffman arriving shortly thereafter. She stows the surprise away in the cabinet and leaves a note for Hoffman on the desk. 2 minutes are left on the clock as Easton winds his way down timer lane. Seriously, he passes 3 timers on his way to the final confrontation. Hoffman gets settled in for the show as the clock ticks down. But what's this? That note is the one he left for Amanda. He was blackmailing her into failing her own game and subsequently getting John killed. Amanda was there the night John and Jill's son died in the womb. Hoffman threw the whole night into disarray. This is, without a doubt, some peak Days of Our Lives. Hoffman's chair is quickly sticky with electricity. It's Jill! In a classic jigsaw twist, she's electrified Hoffman's setup to disable him. Out in the hall, Easton sprints to the end, a timer revealing he's mere seconds away from losing a limb. He dives through the doorway, the door seals shut behind him, and another timer confirms that he arrived with only a second to spare. As the doors slide open, it's revealed that Pamela the reporter is Easton's sister. Oh, it's really weird that he called her babe. Ooh. I want to play a Game of Thrones? Ooh. A camera watches Easton scream that he won, which is probably not a great look in front of the other guests. The mother and son are actually the family of one of Easton's clients, that Diet Paul Rudd who did not survive his lack of treatment. While they're hashing it out, the game ends, and John reveals Tara and her son were in charge of this the whole time. They're here to serve justice to Easton and determine whether he has earned his life. This isn't Easton's game, it's theirs. Easton steps onto the pressure plate, activating the switch in their cage. The switch powers on and thus begins Easton's aggressive acupuncture trap, better known as EAT. Tara can't bring herself to pass judgment, but her son can. Easton is found guilty of privatized healthcare, for which the sentence is death by 15 simultaneous injections of hydrofluoric acid. Finally, let's break down the acid lounge. We've got 2 very large vats of hydrofluoric acid. Those are not cheap. 2 pumps pump the acid up and into the 15 injectors and tubes. A pin releases the acupuncture board onto Easton, who is perched on his pressure plate that triggered the whole system. What a bespoke method of execution. Also, that kid is definitely going to jail. Bye, Easton! Back in command, Hoffman's getting tested again. Jill has finished tying him down and strapping him into a brand new reverse bear trap just for him. The reverse bear trap 2.0 is secured around his head. Jill reveals who the 6 envelopes Beartrap was Hoffman, the sixth and final game of the night. Although it utilizes some of the brake line equipment and mechanisms we're used to seeing, and the gear system is very much cleaned up and streamlined compared to Amanda's trap or her altered version, this thing is full of specialized parts. And as such, it is definitely not a dumpster dive trap. This bear trap includes some significant new features. When Easton stepped onto the pressure plate, the bear trap wirelessly synced and began counting down on a digital timer. That means that we have batteries on board capable of driving the motors that will engage the gears that might kill Hoffman. Jill tucks him in and leaves him be, but Hoffman doesn't waste time. Ever the smartest apprentice, Hoffman offs his hand and frees himself, and then he thrusts his face through the bars of the door, just in time for the device to activate. He takes some damage, but survives. A montage of doors plays as Hoffman howls into the night, and the movie ends. So, Hoffman survived again, seemingly proving John's point, while everyone around him hates his vibe and would rather he just die. How much money came from Hoffman's 401k? How much was pulled from John's piggy mask bank? Let's find out. In total, the traps in Saw 6 cost approximately $35,156.59. In 2024 prices, that's roughly $54,117.08, or 1.7 Toyota Tacomas. By my reckoning, we can safely bill Hoffman for the C.L.E.A.V.E. trap, since he tainted the crime scene so thoroughly, and took a personal recording home with him. That shows a deep investment. We can also bill him for his Naga recorder, but the Strom hand is free. Gross, but free.
Here. Oh, take my hand. Come on. You're gonna fall unless you take my hand.
No.
In total, Hoffman spent approximately $6,153. Could be worse. Still very affordable. Plus, Hoffman just got a promotion, so maybe the bonus covers it. The cheapest trap by far was the Hangout, at approximately $1,700.22. Mostly due to relying on gravity. Write that down. The most expensive trap was, no surprise, Buckshot Roulette, at $8,338. Always with the flashy lights, ridiculous. Let's take a look at how this breaks down across the franchise. As we can see, this film comes in close after Saw 5, but Saw 6 managed to spread its budget out much more evenly amongst its traps, relying on older scavenging tactics and putting victims against themselves, but with the added pressure of running a personal gauntlet through hell. We can also see Jigsaw's expenses approaching $250,000, nearly $330,000 today. That's some serious capital. I know we said he could foot the bill before, but we're really pushing the man's liquid savings at this point. I mean, we gotta be, right? I mean, who sets aside $300,000 for the kids' college fund in the 90s? Did your parents? Because mine sure didn't. Thanks, Dad. Hoffman's running expenses are also piling up, but still well within his means as a thick-lipped, big-hipped cop machine. Slay. And finally, we get a look at the apprentice expenses so far. With a total spent of $224,845.65, Hoffman has spent close to $9,000 compared to Jigsaw's $216,000. Still, John's dead. I mean, as far as we can tell, this was the last game. I mean, who else is left to punish? A young adult fiction memoirist? That would be ridiculous. Join us next time when we discover the end to Hoffman's reign of terror and find out who kidnapped the young adult fiction memoirist in Saw 3D on Foot the Bill! Well, we did it. We're past the halfway mark. Unless you count Saw 11 coming out this year and the Saw video games, which we would love to cover. So what do you think? Did Hoffman set up the first trap? Or is it all still John's dime and plan? Let me know down below. And hey, if you're still hanging around, you know, consider subscribing if you haven't. And if you have subscribed, try clicking the bell. I've heard its ringing prevents Jigsaw's ghost from building traps in your dreams. Huge special thanks to everyone over at Patreon and YouTube memberships. It's not at all necessary for you to join that, but it does mean that we can keep the lights on. Plus, you get early videos, uncensored videos, behind-the-scenes stuff, and access to the Discord. Hey. As always, you make these videos what they are. I love doing this, and I love knowing that you're enjoying it. Especially you, FBI agent. Go outside and get some fresh air while we still can. And remember, I'm here to make stuff. You're here to watch. Thanks.